And it's just remarkable. The cluster itself is beautiful, but the distant galaxies are interesting too. I think the most sought after thing that we'll be looking at are observations of objects that we hadn't expected, so the unknown events. And I've said this lots in the past, but astronomy is in discovery space. And we know a lot about a lot of things, but there's a lot of things out there that we don't know anything about. And these new sorts of instruments, like James Webb, give us new insight into astronomical objects that we already know. But I think more importantly and more exciting is that there will be new objects that we haven't even contemplated yet. So that's what I'm looking forward to. Well, so this one, for example, the planetary nebula, I think the detail, especially in the outer regions, is you can obviously see the difference, and it's remarkable. And so the resolution is much better, and this is what we would have expected from Webb, because it's a much bigger mirror, and so that gives us the higher resolution on the sky, so that we have wonderful images like this. But then that higher resolution allows us to see better details. And seeing better details allow us to make better models and to understand the underlying physics here. So yeah, it's remarkable. And then here, this is the exoplanet spectrum. And so we've seen images from Webb so far. And this is the first example of its other capability, and that is to show a spectrum. This is like the rainbow of light in that part of the electromagnetic spectrum that Webb observes in the infrared. And so that's neat to be able to see that. But then this object is an exoplanet, and what we are seeing with that spectrum is the atmosphere of the exoplanet, which I believe this object is a Jupiter-like planet, so a gas planet. And we see the detection of water in the atmosphere. This is atmospheric. It doesn't mean that there's water on the surface, and there may not even be a surface of this planet. But nonetheless, this capability is spectacular, because that's the holy grail of exoplanet research, is not only to find the exoplanets, but also to understand what's going on chemically. And in this way, we can potentially determine whether there's life on the planet. And then this is a great example of a massive cluster that in and of itself is very interesting, right? So we're seeing this cluster in a new and better way, because we have new and better capabilities with James Webb. And so we see that, and clusters are fantastic objects. They're the largest gravitationally bound things in the universe. And so all of the yellowish fuzzy objects are galaxies in that cluster. Now, two things that are interesting here is that we're using nature to help us observe more distant objects in this case. So that cluster of galaxies is very large, massive. It has a tremendous amount of mass from the stars that we can see, from the gas that's in the galaxies and outside of the galaxies, but within the cluster we can't see in this part of the electromagnetic spectrum, but if we observed in the X-rays we'd be able to see it because it's hot gas. And then huge quantities of dark matter. All of that combined produce what we call a gravitational lens. And gravitating masses, from Einstein, we know that gravitating masses bend light. And they bend light in a way just like an optical lens. And so when we have an astronomical object like this galaxy cluster, we can use its gravitational lensing capabilities to observe more distant objects that are so far away and so faint we wouldn't normally be able to see them. With a gravitational lens, they're magnified, just like an optical lens does, and so we can see them. So in this fantastic image, all of the streaks that appear to be segments of circles are more distant galaxies behind the cluster, further away from us and from the cluster, that are being gravitationally lensed by that cluster. And so in this way, we're seeing those distant galaxies, again, in a way that we wouldn't normally be able to see because they're too faint. And with the fantastic capabilities of Webb, both the sensitivity to faint light, the resolution, and then also the wavelength that it's observing in, these objects are very, very distant. And so we're able to study the very distant universe. 13 billion light years away or so. And so this shows, in one image, it shows being able, with James Webb, to see our old favorites in a better way, and then also to be able to see new objects, in this case, very, very distant galaxies from the very early universe. And that's the magic of James Webb, I think. Yep. Oh, wow. So this is another old favorite, but seen in new light. And again, this is the first time I've seen this, but I'm expecting that the red, pink filamentary objects are star-forming regions. We're observing it with Webb, and so, you know, star-forming regions are, before the stars have formed, they're cold gas, and that cold gas is radiating in the infrared. We're seeing tremendous detail of these star-forming regions, and the galaxy on the lower left is somewhat of a spiral galaxy, modified in a way that I'll come to in a second, but kind of like our Milky Way, and we see those star-forming regions spread throughout the disk. The galaxy, or in fact two galaxies on the right, are, I think they're interacting with each other, and those two are furthermore interacting with the galaxy on the left, and there's some galaxies off to the top of the image as well. And so those interactions, they're sloshing back and forth through each other, they're gravitationally orbiting each other and pulling off streamers of material that we see on the right there, and those streamers of material, gas, are being pulled off and flung into intergalactic space, but that interaction is also compressing the gas clouds and spurring star formation, which is why we see those glowing knots of material, the pinkish-reddish material there. So we're seeing both star formation that's occurring within the galaxy, but it's also almost certainly caused by the galactic interactions. And this is a common occurrence in the universe, and certainly in the early universe, where the universe was smaller than it is today, galaxy interactions are very common. And so observing objects like this that are closer to us, where we can see the detail, this allows us to understand that process of galaxy collision and interaction. How does it occur? How does it affect the galaxies? Because there is some sort of effect. After these collisions happen, we might have a different sort of galaxy afterwards. And so, you know, what does that look like? And then what's happening with the star formation here? You know, I come back to this, that each of these galaxies almost certainly has a supermassive black hole in the middle. And so those black holes, after the galaxies collide, the collision may drive material onto the black hole and feed the black hole, we say. But also, if these galaxies are destined to collide and to merge into one, then presumably the three supermassive black holes that are in the three galaxies that we see here will merge and combine into a larger black hole. And so these are processes that are going on throughout the universe, certainly in the early days. Being able to observe them up close and personally gives us more insight. And then I'm struck, as with all the other images, that we see the more distant galaxies in the background. And again, almost every object that we see in this image is a more distant galaxy. So this is a universe filled with galaxies. It's just amazing. So yes, their final image here is this star-forming region, nearby star-forming region within our galaxy. And you know, why would we want to observe that? Because again, you know, they're close, we can get detail and we can understand star formation, which is an important fundamental activity in astronomy. And I think the most stunning thing here is just the resolution and the detail that we see. This is a big gas cloud that is forming lots and lots of stars. And so we see stars in the background, and they're eroding that gas cloud along the top there. We see that nice sharp edge. The thing that struck me most is, again, the exquisite detail that's visible here and how sharp that eroded edge is. So the stars towards the top of that image, and I'm assuming this is not my area of study, but based on what we're seeing here, those stars have turned on, and you know, now they're sending out photons, high energy photons, ultraviolet photons, and X-ray, and those high energy photons are eroding the gas that has remained, the cocoon of gas that's remained after the stars have turned on, and it's starting to erode it away, and that's, I think, why we have that nice sharp edge there. It's just phenomenal, and we see cavities in the middle where stars have formed, and they're blowing out holes within that gas cloud, and we see reflection from stars that we can't see directly along the top ridge, for example, and in the middle part of middle left there, and then just all the stars at the top are probably stars from that cluster. It's just remarkable, the detail that we see here. And so again, this is a fundamental process. All stars go through an environment like this when they're born and turn on. And so understanding them better with an instrument like the James Webb is what it's all about, right? And so it'll make tremendous advances in all aspects of astronomy, from stars and planets to the most distant universe.